even though these clusters might sound kind of awful, we want to play them with as much musicality as we possibly can. So. And then we can repeat those clusters in the correct rhythm for the piece. And then as we open it up, we'll find that the music's already there because we're not listening for each of those individual notes now. We're listening for that entire phrase.
Yes.
All right, so we've already mapped out that phrase in our mind without dealing with all those little fingery things. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Right. Book two, Journey Through the Classics. We start getting 3-4-6-8. We start getting a little bit of F major, G major. I have a piece to show for you. It's a Telemann minuet in G major. So we have both our 3-4 and our G major demonstrated here. So here's what Abby Whiteside would do. Instead of starting your student playing just left to right, she'd start with them playing only the notes on the beat, so leaving out all those pesky little triplets. Okay. And it actually makes total musical sense, right, when we outline it like that. And you have to have your students make this a phrase while you're doing it, okay? And the reason is that different muscles get activated. When we're thinking fingers, we're thinking far ahead. We're just thinking everything out here. We get sounds like that. That just sound no, 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 no. If we're thinking phrase, our arm, our elbow, our torso are all getting more engaged. And when we just tuck in those little notes, it's effortless. But it also trains the ear to not listen for those little notes, but to go through that long phrase. So start without those notes in there. From book three of Journey Through the Classics, we have an echo six. For $50, no, I don't have dollars. For 50 points, what is an echo six?
Scottish dance.
Scottish dance, beautiful. I always love this. This is a Beethoven echo six. So it's a French word for a Scottish dance written by a German composer. Method tends to take tapping a few steps further. So first of all, when you have your student tap, don't have them use their fingers. Here's my opinion. You can feel free to disagree. What they might just do is play it on their piano. But again, this is encouraging finger-wise thinking, and it's making them think too much about the notes. When you're doing that, you're still thinking about your fingering, your notes, all those things. We want to just isolate that rhythm. Okay? So a few things you can do. So I have my students tap with their full hand. On the keyboard, and you want to have them tap with expression. So not just this is technically correct, but it's not music. Right? You want the dynamics to be there, you want the energy to be there, you want the accents to be there, you want all the feeling of the music to be there when they tap. One thing that I've suggested to my students when they tap that really helps is that you can ask them to move their hand back and forth through the piano. And this is for the reason that if they do this, they tense up in their arm. Whereas if they start moving this way, they keep their elbow loose. So it's training good muscle motion, right? Once they can do that, we can have them tap the right hand part with their hands and the left hand part with their feet. So this gets everything energized. My teacher would tell me that when you're sitting at the piano, you don't have to move and be super expressive, but you want to be like a hummingbird. So a hummingbird is very active and working really hard just to stay in one place. And that's how you want your body to be at the piano. You want it to all be active and ready and excited, even if it's not necessarily moving. So that helps get the lower body involved. Okay, I'm gonna give you some really just maniacal tapping exercises now. So once you can do right hand with your hands, left hand with your feet, you can do the right hand with your right limbs, your left hand with your left limbs, right? And if your student has really just pissed you off that day, you can ask them to put their right hand and left foot together, and their left hand and right foot together. When I practice fugues, I practice soprano, alto, tenor. Bass.
Oh,
and I don't know, I haven't come across a five-voice fugue that I've attempted to do this with yet, but I might have to grow a tail or something like that. So, to get that rhythmic energy that you want for the echo stays, have them spend some time tapping. And once they tap, you can also have them spend some time marching. To really feel that beat and the energy of that beat and the body involvement that that takes. Because it's not all happening here, it's happening with the entire body. So that's a piece from book three.
Can I assume that you're doing this with your beginners to take them up to this, or did you just throw this out a transfer student in a junior high? I mean,
By this you mean the Abby Whiteside exercises?
Yeah, I mean, did you start these little tapping exercises with beginners and work your way up?
Yeah, ideally. Definitely the splashing and the rhythm tapping I would do with everybody. Some exercises take a certain kind of student to kind of be able to parse the music in different ways. And so I do try to train that subtly in my beginners, but sometimes, especially with my college students, they come in and they're not able to think that way at all. So I have to start them kind of at a lower level with some of these things. Yes?
Yeah, I think older kids like rhythm more than they like melody. I mean, they're really into the beat, so.
Get them involved. Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Yes?
The other beauty of that series is that it comes with this again, and so they can do this tapping because I do.
They can tap along with the recording.
I have to tap along with this.
Thank you so much. Yes.
If I can throw in one point there for anybody that's doing Royal Conservatory exams, you can get the full set of all those books with the audio for maybe $25.
Yeah.
And Frederick Harris just raised their prices, and you know I can get through students through exams using just these books here.
Beautiful.
And you can use them for several levels.
Thank you. Yeah, these do come in four different books, or you can buy the all-in-one. And yeah, I think it's just $25
for the whole set. And there are some up to level 9 pieces in the Journey Through the Classics if you're doing a music development program from Rose.
Beautiful. Thank you.
That's a nice replacement book.
You have one CD with all those, or is it a download?
I believe it's a download. Does anybody in the back want to correct me? Everything's a download now.
I still buy it. Well, I still get it with the disc, but I buy the entire. I don't buy the books individually.
You have the entire set.
Yeah.
Cindy, do you want to jump in here? Do you have
the entire set has a CD and it's on your forms that I mentioned before. So. The entire set that you were mentioning
is on the CD. Thank you. I don't want to say something wrong in front of the people who really know. Okay, I have one more Abby Whiteside exercise to show you, and this actually comes directly from one of her books. She tells the story that she had a young student no, sorry. She had a first-time student come in, an adult student, and she saw, the first piece she assigned them was this Bach Little Prelude in C minor. Do you guys teach with this piece ever? It's... Okay. So she said the first thing she did was have her cluster it into a chorale so that they can hear the way that the chords move. Thing is maybe a little bit unexpected, and I want you guys to all do it with me. So the left hand here goes 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So she had the student sit on the bench and lean to the left side. If you feel that you have these two sitting bones here that you usually stay on, for beats 1 and 3, you're going to lean to that left sitting bone. For beat 2, you're going to lean to the right. Okay, I'm going to do it mirrored so that I'm not confusing you. So let's try it together. Everybody sit up. Okay, good group. Look at this. So we're going to start to the left. We're going to go left on beats 1 and 3. We're in 3-4, remember. So it's going to be 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. You guys all look ridiculous. No, I'm just kidding. 1, 2, 3. That feels nice, right? So you're engaging with the rhythm. 2, 3. Without having to use your fingers. Great, thank you. But I think what we find with a lot of our students is that they put the rhythm here. And so if they mess up, the rhythm gets disrupted. But we don't want that, right? The rhythm is this train going down the track, and whatever else might happen on that train, it needs to keep going forward. So by putting the rhythm somewhere like your butt or elsewhere, you can get your students to feel that rhythm naturally and they'll have more control. And also with that leaning, what did you guys feel? Did it feel like a very strict rhythm, or did you feel like you kind of had, you could use gravity and have a little bit of leeway with it? It feels expressive, right? It's like a dance. So then you combine those two. You take the chorale, go 1, 2, 3. So I just want to show you how far these Journey Through the Classics book goes. So one of the last pieces in here is one of my favorites. It's To a Wild Rose, the great Edward McDowell piece. By this time, we're in A major. We have 4 voices going at once. We have some more complex harmonies. We have kind of some different counterpoint entering from some different places. So it's requiring a lot of musical skills from your student. So I'll play a little bit here. Sonatas and start pushing them into some real repertoire. So I think this is just an incredibly useful series, and it's cheap, as was pointed out. So those are the Journey Through the Classics. Okay, guys, I think it's time for jazz. I had a teacher at Eastman who said that there's two four-letter words associated with improvisation. Jazz and fear. So I want to start with the piece that's in your packet. You don't have to buy this. This is called Big Band Shout. This is one of my first pieces with Hal Leonard. And this is for Hal Leonard level 2. So when they're in those C and D books, they should be able to play this. And here's the idea with this piece. If you've heard of big band performance, the most standard way that it goes are that you have somebody playing or singing the melody of the piece. Then you have some improvised solos. And then you have what's called the shout chorus. And the shout chorus is this bit of new material where everybody's playing, the drums are bashing, the trumpets are playing in their highest register, and it gets really exciting. This is where the dancers might work up into their most feverish dancing. And I want to show you for a piece called Little Darling what the shout chorus sounds like on piano. Imagine a big band blaring them out, right? And so that's what this is supposed to be for a younger student. Now there's something that you need to know. Lots of times when piano teachers know about jazz style, it pretty much stops with that 2 8th notes equal swung 8th notes. Right? That's about the end. But there's a lot more to it. I regret to have to tell you. And one thing is quarter notes. If you just have quarter notes, how do you articulate them in jazz?
Sticky staccato.
Sticky staccato, I like that. Okay, so quarter notes should be long, but separated. I call them fat. They should kind of sit back on the beat and be real dense and long, but not legato. So listen one more time to that shout chorus. These are all quarter notes. Slowing down because they're so fat there on the beat, right? And so even though this is marked as a slur, the slur is not to indicate legato, the slur is indicating the phrases. So we want the student to play. Two functions, right? They mean legato and they mark phrases. So here, they're marking phrases. So I'm going to play this for you. I'll do my best to play the student part with the teacher accompaniment. Jazz can mean so many different things. Studying jazz can mean just playing kind of cute jazz pieces like this, or sometimes to students it even just means playing something a little bit more energetic, with a little bit more rhythm to it. like as was being pointed out, students get into rhythm. So some of them don't want to play that lyrical classical piece. Some of them want to play something that sounds more like what they hear on the radio. To other students, they might want to be able to read chord symbols, right? They might want to be able to play from a lead sheet in church. Or they might want to be able to play in their big band in school. They might want to be able to improvise. You have sometimes adults who think of jazz as Sinatra and jazz standards. They just want to play those songs that they heard growing up. So the first thing that I recommend you doing when you have a student who comes to you and says, oh, I want to learn jazz, is figure out exactly what they want. And I'm going to try to show you some books and pieces that would help you teach them in each case. So for, again, a young student who might just want something a little more rhythmic and fun, I wrote this book called Myths and Monsters. This is a fun Halloween book. It actually has a good St. Patrick's Day song, but we're too late for that. and it, because it's got all kinds of pieces featuring goblins and ghouls. You have pieces called Dracula, Leprechaun, The Mermaid's Call, My Scaly Alien, T-Rex, Werewolf, The Wily Sphinx, Yeti Blues, and The Zombie Song. Yeah. And most of these have lyrics written by me. Fun fact about me is that I have a master's degree in English comparative literature, and I love writing lyrics as well as music. So I tried to write lyrics that I thought would be fun for both the student and the teacher, that have some little puns in there and fun things. So what did I decide I'd play for you? This is one of the more lyrical pieces here, but it's called The Mermaid's Call. So let me play this for you. So this is for late elementary level. Seeking healthy blood. In Transylvania, he will drain ya. Dracula, Prince of Night. Gladly he'll arrange a meeting with his fangs. The problem, sadly, that he's batty. Dracula, Prince of Night. Kind of goes on like that. So I'll play, there's a teacher accompaniment again. I'll try to play a little bit of both. Goes like this. Kind of fun pieces in this book, Myths and Monsters for late elementary.